Let's get the reaction of Attorney Domingo Cayosa, who joins us live from Tuguegarao City this morning. He's the president of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. Good morning, Attorney Cayosa, and thank you very much for joining us.
Good morning, Christian, and good morning to our televiewers.
Okay, first, what's the plan of the IBP? Will the IBP raise this matter before the Supreme Court once President Rodrigo Duterte signs this into law?
Well, IBP already made known its position. We wrote to the leaders of Congress, and we came up with a public statement. Our focus are on the patently unconstitutional provisions in the anti-terrorism bill. If it passed into law by the signature of the president, then one possibility is for IBP or any other group or any other affected person to question its constitutionality before the Supreme Court.
Okay, talk to us about the process, because there's such a thing as a facial challenge, right? But in this case, can that actually apply in the case of the Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020 without any complainant to which that particular law has been applied already?
But it's possible, because if you look at Section 29, it clearly gives the Anti-Terrorism Council the authority to give written authority for military personnel and law enforcement agents to arrest and detain for 14 to 24 days suspected terrorists. And the Constitution is very clear that only the courts can issue warrants of arrest. So that could be a challenge on its face. Secondly, under Article 7, Section 18 of the Constitution, even in extreme cases of rebellion and invasion, and the privilege of the writ of habeas corpus is suspended, our Constitution only gives a maximum of 3 days within which the government has to charge those who are detained and arrested before the courts of our country. This law gives them 14 to 24 days of detention without bringing or charging the suspects or the accused before the courts of law.
Okay.
To our mind, that would also be a patent unconstitutionality that we hope the Supreme Court will consider and rule upon.
Now, I understand that Senator Panfilo Lacson, the principal author of this Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020, wrote the IBP, specifically you, clarifying certain things that you raised against the proposed law. Now you mentioned, for example, the written order, which was contained in, I think, in Section 29. He clarified in his letter to you was that letter was not did not pertain to any arrest order, but in fact, actually, it doesn't add any additional powers to the Anti-Terrorism Council. Because according, again, to Section 45, sabi niya, you have to read this in its entirety. And Section 45 does not give any judicial or quasi-judicial powers to the ATC. How do you respond to that?
Right. Let's be accurate. IBP wrote to the leaders of Congress, the Speaker and the Senate President. We did not receive any letter from Senator Lacson. I understand he made a tweet in his Twitter account. Unfortunately, the explanation of one senator, even if he is the principal author, does not change the letter of the law. Because when you talk about laws, it is what is written, not what is explained by the author after the law is passed by Congress. The Section 29 is very clear. It gives, it talks of written authority by the ATC. Now, so when this law will be used, then ATC can cite that provision. And the tweet of Senator Lacson will be of no moment. And even if we bring this case to the Supreme Court, the Supreme Court will look at the law as it is written, because the law is supposed to guide not only the senators or IBP or the lawyers, but everybody. Everybody. As a matter of fact, this early, if you look at the column of Secretary Sal Panelo in Daily Tribune, he believes that ATC can validly issue those orders. So between the tweet of Senator Lacson and the thinking of Secretary Panelo, perhaps in his personal capacity, we don't know, magkaiba na. So much more for our countrymen.
Yeah, so it seems that there is indeed vagueness, in particular in that section that you're talking about, no? Section 29.
There's no vagueness in the law. It says upon written order or authority of the ATC. So the law is interpreted based on the normal meaning of the words used by the legislators. So far, only Senator Lacson has come forward with that kind of explanation. The House has not. And we hear one key official of government who believes that the ATC can be authorized. So he's correct that we should look at the entirety of the law. If you relate Section 29 to Section 25 of the bill, which allows the Anti-Terrorism Council to designate upon suspicion and probable cause people or organizations to be terrorists, and allows the Anti-Money Laundering Council to freeze the funds and assets of these suspected terrorists, then you would see that the intention of the law and the wording is very clear. It gives judicial power to the Anti-Terrorism Council, which is not a court, it's part of the executive. So there goes the checks and balances carefully crafted in our 1987 Constitution.
Mm-hmm. But doesn't that run counter also to Section 45, which says that the ATC shall not be granted any judicial or quasi-judicial authority under the bill?
Yeah, Section 45 is very clear, except that under Section 29, it contemplates of an administrative order authorizing. So, if the intention is to clarify, so why don't they clarify it rather than have conflicting provisions in the law? Mm-hmm. What IBP is harking at is, please make the law very clear. Even the definition of who is a terrorist and who is a suspect, these things are vague, and it doesn't put proper notice the citizens of this republic. So if it can be improved, if it can be made better so that it does not run counter to any constitutional provision, why don't we do it that way?
Okay. Now, just to be clear, you didn't receive this June 15 letter coming from the senator? This is addressed to you.
We do, then we will gladly respond to it. We have a very high regard for Senator Lacson. Unfortunately, he's the only one saying that. At the end of the day, it will not be Senator Lacson who will be interpreting it. It will be the Supreme Court. And we welcome his statement that he will join anyone who will march in the streets if this is abused. But what you're saying is, why do we have to wait for these things to happen? If it can be clarified, if it can be improved, then it might be the better alternative.
Okay. Now, how about the position taken by Senator Lacson that, of course, the 3-day detention rule is in place already in our laws, but it doesn't actually prevent Congress from expanding it, because according to him, the 3-day detention applies only during the suspension of the privilege of the writ of habeas corpus.
That's one interpretation that the Supreme Court will have to settle. Because if you look at the totality again, as Senator Lacson has suggested, of the Constitution, even when the privilege of the writ of habeas corpus is suspended under extreme circumstances, the framers of the Constitution, because of the sad experiences we had under martial law, placed a limit of 3 days. As a matter of fact, if you look at the deliberations of the Constitutional Commission in 1987, the initial period was 5 days, but they shortened it to 3 days. If you look at those deliberations, it seems that that's the maximum set by the Constitution. Terrorism can be local. It does not necessarily imperil the existence of the Republic, unlike rebellion and invasion. So it's with more reason that the three-day limit set by the Constitution should cover the terrorism law.
Okay. The claim by Senator Lacson that the written authorization given to the that power given to the Anti-Terrorism Council is supposedly premised on a valid arrest warrant, and that it doesn't seek to add any other exceptions when it comes to warrantless arrests. Attorney Kayo.
Well, we welcome that clarification, and we welcome that clarification. And if that is the case, then the law should speak that kind of language or intention. And by the way, if it refers to warrantless arrest, so there's no need for Section 29.
Oh, because it's already available in the laws, right?
Yes, the rules of court already provide for that. There's so much jurisprudence about that. But there's a big difference, because in warrantless arrest, it's the law enforcer himself, the policeman, who sees the crime being committed, or it has just been committed and is running after the suspect, or it is about to be committed in his presence. In this particular case, so it is authorized because he knows personally a crime is being committed. In Section 29, it is a collegial body far removed from the scene of the crime, giving the allowing the authorizing the warrantless arrest. So there's a disconnect between the explanation and the clear, simple words used in Section 29. But unfortunately, when laws are interpreted, the Supreme Court will look at the law, not on the opinion of IBP or myself or any other. It first starts with the wording of the law. When the law is clear, it will be applied, and the executive and the ATC will have the right to apply Section 29 as they see fit.
Precisely. Oh. But how do you actually apply this in actual circumstances? For example, of course, authorities are allowed to conduct surveillance as long as it's granted authority by the Court of Appeals. So if you are actually conducting surveillance and you're hearing or even seeing that a suspected terrorist is actually doing something illegal based on this proposed Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020, you can actually effect an arrest. Is that the case?
Yes, because that is in their personal presence. They know personally. So why do you need the written authority of the ATC if there's no intent to give it that power? By the way, if you look at the bill, they can go to the Court of Appeals to get the necessary warrants. So what's the use for the ATC? Why don't we just take away that provision about the written authority? Because if they have enough grounds or evidence to warrant an arrest order, then why are we not content with going to the Court of Appeals? Why do we still have Section 29 that mentions the written authority by the ATC?
Okay,
there is no need for that. Under the whole concept of the law.
Okay. Finally, Attorney Cayosa, help us understand the relationship between the power of the ATC to designate individuals or groups as terrorists and the prescription order, which is a power reserved with the courts. And in fact, there's a preliminary order of prescription that is included in the proposed Anti-Terrorism Act. What's the difference?
The big difference is the ATC can and designate a person or an organization as a suspected terrorist, and then AMLA can freeze your assets and your funds. That's taking of your property upon mere probable cause. Ex parte ito. Mm. You don't have a chance to defend yourself or present countervailing evidence.
Mabilis.
In the prescription by the court, at least you have a chance to give your side. And the other big difference is that the courts belong to the judicial branch of government. They are supposed to be independent, and they will review the evidence of the presented by the executive branch. The Anti-Terrorism Council is part of the executive branch of government. Mm-hmm. And it is the same executive branch of government that is presenting evidence to their colleagues in the executive branch. That is very clearly beyond the checks and balances prescribed by our Constitution.
But do you actually see any problem with that preliminary order of prescription, wherein the court can actually make that order on someone who is suspected of being a terrorist, and then after or within 6 months, the court has to conduct hearings to determine whether to make that order permanent or to lift it?
Well, it is preliminary. It is preliminary, so it can be lifted. But see, the problem with that is there's such a long period of time by which there's already a limitation on your property. It amounts to taking of your property. Under the Constitution, life, liberty, and property cannot be taken away from you without due process of law. Due process of law under the Constitution requires judicial determination of basis for this. So to our mind, giving such a long period of time before the court can actually intervene and before anyone who's suspected can actually defend himself runs counter to the intent and spirit of our Constitution.
Okay, Attorney Domingo Cayosa, thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.